if you do this, then it creates people like me who are advocating, like, they're not paying me for this. And like that 15 minutes of effort, like, is probably the resource that went into that, they're probably getting like tenfold of that just from like people like me talking about this kind of stuff.
What is up, everybody? Welcome to this episode of Sales Stories in Real Life, brought to you by Common Room. Common Room helps you tap into the modern customer journey to give your go-to-market team superpowers. I'm your host, Alex Bruski, and this is the show where professional salespeople share their stories about memorable buying experiences. Today, we've got a very special guest from the Common Room team. We've got Kevin White with us here today. Kevin leads the marketing and sales development teams at Common Room and has helped Common Room to land logos like Figma, Asana, Notion, Snowflake, amongst many others. Kevin, super impressive customer list. I love what Common Room is doing. All that aside, I hear you had a really interesting buying experience when you were looking for a webinar platform. What happened there, Kevin?
Yeah. Thanks so much for having me, Alex. And yeah, I can, it's very top of mind to actually have some things that happened today, even in this buying experience, which was buying, or purchasing a webinar platform. So, if we rewind back to what we're using in the past, I mean, I feel like the whole webinar platform space is challenging because there's a lot of players out there. A lot of people just go with like, oh, we're using Zoom for meetings, like they have a webinar thing, let's just use that instead. But what we initially had at Common Room was built from Hopin, and it was called Hopin Sessions. And we purchased it based on a number of criteria, like it was a little bit more modern and allowed you to change backgrounds. People could comment with emojis. It was like a little step up from like the traditional like Zoom, or back in the day it was GoToMeeting webinar platforms. And so we chose that. It integrated well with our CRM. It was actually really simple to use and the price point was great. But I think it was in the fall, maybe it was pretty late in the year, they were purchased by Ring Central. And for whatever reason, Ring Central decided to deprecate Hopin Sessions. So they're like, you have a deadline, it's February 1. So we were then in the market for a new webinar platform. And so that was kind of I love to think about like, you know, what are the signals, especially for my team on the sales development side, is like, what are the signals? What are the triggers that get someone to go from like, I'm passively in market to like, no, I'm like actively looking to buy something? Because I love to set that as like a starting point for like, these are the priority people to go after because they're now in market for a solution. And that sunsetting of Hopin Sessions was something that was like, I'm sure a lot of other webinar platforms were looking at as like, this is a trigger that like anyone who's on this needs to then find a different solution. So that was our really big looming trigger. And we had just a few months to make a decision. So that kind of set me on the track of, you know, looking and referring, looking to peers and colleagues and other people who have been using webinar platforms. Some of our criteria was like, you know, does it integrate well with our CRM? It can be a real headache to like upload and download and export and do all the stuff to like CSVs. And we just wanted it to be something like super simple, like we had with Hopin. So after some exploration and looking at different Slack communities, talking with some friends in the space and just seeing what's out there through like word of mouth and what people are talking about on LinkedIn and stuff like that, kind of just made the decision that like AirMeet seemed like the best option before doing some sort of like a, you know, proof of concept or like RFP. I don't think that's like exactly necessary for something like a webinar platform. So one of the key deciding factors was actually with a partnership that we had with this group, this community called Rev Genius. And so Rev Genius runs their virtual events, which is something we're like considering doing ourselves at some point potentially. They run their whole program for webinars and virtual events on AirMeet. So I had direct access to ask someone of like, hey, you know, what do you think of this product? Like, is it something that you would buy again? Like, what are some hangups? And like, they were glowing referrals for the products. And that just kind of like solidified my decision to like move forward and set up a pilot and trial and make sure it works and then purchase the product. So did that, didn't talk with anyone on the sales side of things or anything like that. I signed up and then they wanted to book a demo with me to just do some sort of like, well, I didn't know exactly. I was like, oh, maybe this is where the pitch comes in, where they're going to say like, oh, it looks like it's $100 a month at surface value, but actually like you need to pay $30,000 a year and do an annual contract. So, you know, I wasn't exactly sure what I was getting, but I chatted with someone, I think it was only for 15 minutes actually. And they kind of like heard what we're trying to do, you know, gave me a few pointers and then were like, this plan is for you. And it's the startup plan or the, whatever the like, tier package we chose, maybe it was like a team plan or something like that, which was, I think we're paying like $100 to $150 a month or something like that. So like nothing to balk at. Like, I think I just pulled out the credit card and bought it within the next like 15 minutes after that conversation. And then, you know, set up and all that kind of stuff was as easy as they claimed it to be. And now we're successfully made the transition from Hopin Sessions, which as of Feb 1, I guess that's today, is now, no longer. And we've had 3 different webinars on, AirMeet already. And, so far pretty happy customers. The other thing that I will mention about the experience is like, it didn't just end at that first sale, or once we put in our credit card, they actually followed up with me to make sure things were going well. And then the CEO, I don't know how they do this. It must be some sort of like scaled solution to like reach out to customers or something, but the CEO connected me with me on LinkedIn. They also sent me a little like gift package for, it was like a gift basket with crackers and cheese and salami and stuff like that, which was great. I love food. And then just today, the CEO messaged me on LinkedIn and he said, hey, like, hope you're liking the platform. Let me know if there's any like bugs or issues you're running into. I was able to share some product feedback around how I want the video to be oriented vertically so that we can share vertical video on social. He seemed receptive to that, gave me some pointers. And so the whole like pre-sale, actual sale and post-sale process has felt very easy and also like, you know, concierge-like, but in a way that is not too much of a burden or too much time spent online. And so, yeah, I mean, I feel like, you know, maybe they'll give me the product for free after giving them this glowing review. But like, I really think that was a world-class selling experience. And I'm curious how they do it, because I feel like they probably have a lot more customers that they roll this out to. So it seems like a full-on, well-thought-out customer experience from like the start to the finish and beyond. So, yeah.
That's fantastic. I love the clear breakdown of the pre and post sale process. I have a lot of questions about both. Let's start with the pre, and then I'm going to do the post sale later, because I think post sale is so overlooked. So we're definitely not going to skip that. One thing that I did want to point out is I think kind of the irony of all this is that it all started with a trigger event, and that's very much what Common Room does, right, is it helps to identify these trigger events that are happening within your book of business. So I think that's kind of cool that you had like the opportunity to almost like have the experience from the other side. And I mean, talk about a trigger event, right? Like a product being sunsetted is as strong of a trigger event as you'll ever find. And I think that this like really perfectly encapsulated the modern customer journey is you had to now find a new replacement. And the first thing that you do is you go online and you do your research and you talk to the folks in your Slack community and you see what people are talking about on LinkedIn, and you even reach out to a current customer to get the sense of, hey, what's it like to be on the platform? Would you buy this again, right? I don't know the exact stat off the top of my head, but a lot of buyers are coming to us 60, 70, 80, in your case, maybe even 90, 95% through the buying process without even talking to a salesperson, right? This is where things are kind of steadily moving. So I'd like to start there. obviously a referral and recommendation from someone in your network that you trust, I mean, is as good as gold. Were there any other platforms that like got these sorts of glowing reviews, or was it just like a culmination of like your own research plus referrals? Was there like anybody that ever even came close to competing, or was it just pretty much like
I didn't. So I think that stat, we use it a good amount of times, or we use it a lot at Covenroom. I think it's the Gartner says that 95% of the buyer journey is like outside of the salesperson's purview. So who knows how they get that number? And I'm sure it's inaccurate one way or the other. But like, it's a lot that happens outside of the salesperson's the rep's purview. But you know, going back to the question of you know, do we look at and evaluate other things? We definitely like did, or like looked around. The thing with like platforms like review sites like G2, which is one thing I checked out, but there's just so much noise there, and then everyone on there has like pretty glowing reviews because they incentivize their customers who are happy to write a review. So it seems like a very biased channel in some ways, especially when there's a lot of volume and hard to make sense out of things. So yeah, that's what kind of led me to going back to peers and communities and seeing what people say and where there's a lot of enthusiasm around a product. I feel like that's usually, and if it's in an authentic way, that makes me pretty comfortable around making a purchase. Also, like it wasn't a one-way door. It's not like we had to purchase a webinar solution and then like we couldn't backtrack. So it was relatively low risk based on, you know, the terms, which is like monthly payments. And so I felt like we were pretty de-risked there, other than like our time spent implementing it. But all these things are kind of figured out now. So like, you know, it doesn't take, you know, I think the whole setup of from start to finish took maybe like less than an hour to like get it up and working and integrating with our CRM. So like, not bad. I would say like the other candidate was kind of like the default, which would just be like, we're using Zoom. Like Zoom has a webinar thing. It kind of works well with our CRM. Like, let's go with that. But I do like how the AirMeet in this sense, like up levels the user experience with kind of like a more fun, like they're building it for webinars and they're not building it for like what we're doing right now, which is like back and forth, like video chat. So yeah.
Super helpful context too. And there was one thing that you said in the pre-sale process that really stood out to me, and I'm like so bullish on, is that you said they made it easy to buy, right? It was, hey, I'm very much far through the buying process, right? Someone reached out to you to do a demo, and what, it was a 15-minute demo, right? Like, I'm sure they didn't show you every single little nook and cranny, right? In that 15 minutes, they probably showed you what you were looking for. You were very close to a decision. You had a very strong, compelling trigger event to make a change, and they kind of got out of your way and made it easy for you, right? Like, what's that experience like as a buyer? Because I'm sure you've had other times where folks either like make it difficult, or, you know, they want to take up a bunch of your time when it's like, you know, your full-time job isn't to be a buyer, right? Like, you're literally leading a team. Like, this is kind of something that you're doing on top of that. Like, what's that experience like as a buyer when a seller just makes it easy for you?
Yeah. I think the one thing you called out there is just the 15 minute time interval, whereas like a lot of people ask for more time, you know, a half an hour, 45 minutes, which inevitably like turns into an hour after hearing a pitch. And like, just that, like knowing in your mind that it's like, it's even if it goes completely off the rails and wrong, it's only 15 minutes and you have an out. Like, that is one way to lower the barrier to entry, is like, okay, the time commitment here is not a ton. And then, you know, I was a little bit worried, you know, that, you know, having to talk with someone would like make it take too long to get something implemented. And like, we're up on a time crunch, like we had to get something implemented by, you know, in like a month or month and a half amount of time. And so I was like, if I talk to someone, like, is that going to like lead to negotiations and like all this other stuff? But, you know, they were just kind of like, yeah, just enter your credit card in. This is the right thing for you. I think one thing that, you know, they did well in this is like kind of assess where we were. And like, if they, I think the reason for them doing that is like, if I'm an enterprise customer that has like a bunch of seats and like runs webinars at scale, you know, if we do go the self-serve route, then we're going to be like really dissatisfied with the product. So it's kind of like a way to route people to the right plans. And then it's like that helps. I'm guessing that helps them out a lot with retention, because they're like, okay, based on what we know about you, like this is the plan that you should be on, even though it seems like a heavy resource for like a human resource to like do a, you know, our annual contract is total is probably like $1,500 or less. So that seems like a lot the salesperson is not going to get commission on, but like they probably strike enough of those conversations where it like justifies having that resource, you know, direct someone in the right way. And, for like a kind of like transactional sale. So yeah, I don't know, overall, like pretty seamless experience. And, you know, we were up and running in like less than a week's time. So
I love your point there about the time duration, because that's exactly what's going through every buyer's head, right? Is like, what's not just my financial risk, but like, what's my opportunity cost, right? If I'm going to spend an hour on a demo with you, that means I got to take an hour away from this laundry list of items that I have to do. So it was almost like, to your point, like maybe someone gets on the call with you in 15 minutes and realizes that you actually need a greater plan. But now at least there's mutual agreement that that time is necessary to be spent, versus they do kind of a quick, almost gut check at the goal line to just say, hey, let's just make sure this is the right plan for you. Let's take 15 minutes. They do a quick gut check with you. Yeah, it does look like this is your best plan. Here's your credit card, right? And then 15, 20 minutes later, you make a purchase. And it's, again, virtually zero time risk, very little financial risk on your side. Just makes it easy to buy. I love that. I feel like so many people are constantly like shooting themselves in the foot by making things so difficult. And then that kind of perfectly segues into the post-sales process, where, I mean, to your point, this isn't a massive contract, right? I mean, to your point, they sent you cheese and crackers, and, you know, obviously everybody loves food. It puts a smile on everyone's face. They've got the CEO sending you a message afterwards. Obviously, I can, to your point, imagine that the retention and the adoption numbers are so much better versus just doing, let's say, like a clean PLG, where it's like, you just sign up, you put in your credit card, and like, hey, you know, good luck, see you later. Obviously there's some adoption and implementation issues with that. So it seems like just the right amount of salesperson interaction to really sink your teeth in and understand the product and have someone care for you, but not so much that it's like a drag on your time. So like when you make a purchase like that, and especially not a very large one either, right? I mean, under a couple thousand dollars a year, to your point, like that's not, you know, really breaking the bank either way, but they're sending you food. They're getting a message from the CEO. The CEO is taking product feedback that you could take over. What's going through your head while all that happens? I mean, is that just like confirmation that you made a great decision, or what's going through your head there?
Yeah. I mean, one, because I have like a growth marketer, like mindset from my background, I'm like, how do they do this at scale? Because like, it's like the little things that really make a big difference. And like, these are like, I think time-wise, like, you know, shooting someone a message over Slack, or even like, you know, the way that the, you know, the kind of like reward programs work of like sending someone a gift or something like that, those are all pretty like figured out by software. And so like, I imagine like post-sales, you know, total time spent on their end, you know, probably could have been 5 minutes, 15 minutes. And so like, it's these like little things that, to me are like, okay, how do they do this and how do they systematize it? Because like, I want to take that lesson and like apply it to the way we do things at Common Room, which is, you know, we do it in a different way. And like our customer success team does a lot of like onboarding and help, but I'm like, you know, what if we incorporated these little things? Like what if that helps us out with retention? And our contract sizes are like way larger than a couple thousand dollars a year. So that's kind of what was going in my head. It was more of like the lens of, you know, how I would apply this to our sales process. And so, I just kind of like question like how they do it. And then, You know, also, I feel like the other thing that went through my mind is like, okay, if you do this, then it creates people like me who are advocating, like, they're not paying me for this. And like that 15 minutes of effort, like, is probably the resource that went into that, they're probably getting like tenfold of that just from like people like me talking about this kind of stuff. So it probably pays off in that. And I wonder if they did like the math there, the calculus there to figure out like, okay, if we do this, people are going to talk about us, and that's going to be our word of mouth engine. So that's kind of what's going through my mind, is just like, how did they figure out this like kind of like growth loop or word of mouth hack? And like, can we do something like that?
Well, after this, we might just have to have the Airbeat CEO on the show as well. Because I mean, I would love to dig more into this on the back end as well. I just love it. It's so, I mean, even though there's automation there to some extent, I imagine, it's just so human, right? To send someone a gift, to reach out to them and ask for feedback right after they buy, like, it just makes you feel heard. It just makes you feel seen. It just makes you feel appreciated. And one thing I will always like, I'll say this until I'm blue in the face. We never want to admit how emotional sales is, right? Like, we want to just think that we're all just these rational beings that, you know, make all of these rational decisions, but it's really not, right? Like, we're emotional beings. We make emotional decisions and then we rationalize it with logic thereafter. And I think they really kind of put a perfect touch on that exact point. And obviously, to your point, create raving fans like you.
Yeah, it's like I justified my decision by post sales. It's like, oh, I made a decision, like, who knows if it was a good one or not, like, I'm not unhappy with the product at all, but then like it just justifies that I made the right decision with all these like little touch points after the fact. So yeah, I totally get that like psychology play. It's working well.
I love that. So this was again just perfect example of the modern buying journey, in my opinion. So I'm so glad that we got the full story. As we start wrapping up here, if folks are still listening, and if you are, we appreciate you. What would be the one big takeaway that you would give to folks that want to take their buyer's experience to the next level, right? And deliver this sort of experience where it is such a great buying experience that you're willing to go shout it from the mountaintops for free, right? Just because you're such a happy customer. How would you suggest people have more of that, you know, into their personal sales process?
Yeah, this kind of reminds me of, you know, some of the, you know, stuff we talked about earlier, around like what are the unlocks for the sales team and sales and marketing in general. And like one thing that I've like learned in my somewhat long career in the SaaS world and in growth marketing and go to market is that empathy is like such a big unlock for sales and for go to market and for marketing, and just putting yourself in the shoes of the buyer is like such a big deal. And it like helps you like step back and think from first principles and just put yourself in, like, if you're in that situation, like what would your response be? And if you just ask yourself that before any outbound SDR email or any marketing campaign or sales demo, I think that just helps so much with the customer journey, the customer experience. And and like before in my career, I was like, you know, marketing is all about big campaigns and like spending money for optimizing growth. And like now I've much like shifted more to like the softer side of things, which is like, you know, how do we do empathetic marketing and how do we do empathetic sales? Because like, it is like you were saying, like it's an emotional thing. And if you can make that experience better, people are going to like you, they're going to trust you more, and they're going to feel like they made the right decision. And so I feel like that's like such a big unlock for anyone who's like new or for who has like say struggling and is like, you know, take a step back, take a breather and like put yourself in the customer's shoes, and like that empathy goes like a ton. So
that is fantastic advice for those listening. I could not agree more. And this is something I always do my best to do, to your point, on emails, on calls, right? Like just if I was this person, what would I want to hear right now? Or what would I be thinking, right? And that really is a huge unlock as far as being more buyer-centric, right? And being more modern buyer-centric, particularly. So that is fantastic advice, Kevin. Why don't you tell us what you're up to at Common Room? Obviously, I'm seeing you guys in the LinkedIn feed all the time. Speaking of growth marketing, definitely making some noise. Certainly piqued my attention. I mean, I am all in on signal buying 2024 and beyond. So why don't you talk to us about what you're up to and what you're working on?
So kind of related to the whole conversation here. Part of the modern buyer journey is doing the things that are hard, and word of mouth and joining communities and things like that. But there's a software side to that too, where all these different we like to call them like digital breadcrumbs that are left over kind of hard to find, hard to track places like Slack, LinkedIn, Twitter, Reddit, GitHub, your own product data. Like these are all different like buying signals and breadcrumbs that your customers and potential customers are leaving for you, or leaving trails of like context of like what they're doing. And what we're building at Common Room is the more programmatic software way of doing that empathetic modern buyer journey, where we're pulling in all these signals so that your sales team or your market team or your post-sales team can look at all these signals happening across the modern buyer journey and have the right kind of context, so that when they do reach out, they do so in a way with context, and they can also infer how to add value to the conversation and, you know, just be more human with their outbound efforts, because, you know, that is what ultimately gets someone to, you know, think in your way and to like to take a call, to trust you. So we're trying to do that in a more software driven way. And so like, that's what we're all about at Common Room. And I think that message is really resonating and landing well, which is why you're seeing more and more of us and more of that conversation happening on LinkedIn. So
I love what you said there too, digital breadcrumbs, because all of those breadcrumbs add up to a pile, if you will, right? It's like, to your point, like, what social posts are you liking, right? And it's like all of these things that is so impossible for a seller to track across their entire book of business. I mean, it's impossible, right? There's no way a seller could do this and maintain a book of business. You'd almost have to literally hire a department to track all of these things that Common Room is tracking. And to your point, it just encapsulates the modern buyer journey just all into one platform, right? So you have all of this right at your fingertips. You can use those digital breadcrumbs to formulate your POV, to your point, know what your prospects and customers are up to without necessarily hearing from them. So again, I'm all in on signal buying. I think you guys are doing absolutely fantastic work. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on, Kevin. Thanks so much for sharing your wisdom with us. Thanks so much for sharing Common Room's message with us. Any last words before we jump?
No, that's it. Thanks so much for having me. I guess the last plug for Common Room is that we do have a free version. And so anyone here can just jump in, try the product. We'll use that product data as a signal to potentially reach out to you. And that's a good way to get started. If not, you can just hit me up on LinkedIn or email me, kevin@commonroom.io. So yeah.
There you go. Link up with Kevin on LinkedIn. Check out Common Room's free version, which can, of course, help you to more understand the modern buyer journey, give you kind of a taste of what the platform is like. Shoot him an email. Kevin, we again appreciate the time and wisdom so much. Sales Stories and More Life fam, we will see you soon. Thanks again.